impact society and the environment. So currently, the global population is estimated at 7.6 billion, with about 83 million people being added each year. By 2030, we're expected to reach 8.6 billion in population, and by 2050, 9.8 billion. So we're expected to have a dramatic increase in population, and it's already been at a steady increase for many decades. Most of the population growth, according to Mark Montgomery, professor at Stony Brook University, is expected to occur in the cities and towns of poor countries. As we can see by this graph, or chart, it shows that the countries with the highest birth rates happen in sub-Saharan Africa, and we can see that a lot of Africa right now has a birth rate of 5 to 6 children, which is what is in red, and orange is 4 to 5. And we can see other countries have some green and some blue, which are 2 to 3 and 1 to 2. But we can obviously see that in developing countries, particularly in Africa, they have a much higher birth rate. So the issues with overpopulation, a lot of people speculate and wonder about sustainability. And an article published by National Geographic highlights a study made by the Stockholm Resilience Institute, which identified 9 planetary boundaries necessary to sustain the population for many generations. But currently, we have already exceeded the Institute's boundaries for biodiversity loss, nitrogen pollution, and climate change. And surprisingly, a lot of these issues, such as biodiversity, nitrogen pollution, and climate change, can actually be further worsened by overpopulation, leading to my claim that overpopulation causes irreversible devastation to the environment, economy, and society. So looking environmentally, for decades we have already been experiencing environmental damage. As early as 1989, questions were raised about it, and former British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher stated, "What we are now doing to the world by degrading the land surfaces, by polluting the waters, and by adding greenhouse gases to the air at an unprecedented rate, all this is new in the experience of the Earth. It is mankind and his activities which are changing the environment of our planet in damaging and dangerous ways." So she was explaining that industrialization and technology caused by humans is causing the climate change and the environment to become worse. But overpopulation will increase the amount of people, and thus will increase the amount of people using technology and industry, creating even more pollution and even more environmental damage. And to even add on to that fact is the fact that developing countries are expected to modernize and start using more technology, as an article from the database Issues and Controversies explains that a growing population's effect on the environment will be particularly detrimental, as more and more families in developing countries will live similar lives to people in the Western world. So, looking at this graph of a carbon footprint, if we consider the fact that the population is already increasing and even more of a percentage of the global population will begin to use these technologies, we can see that things such as electricity and fuel that have high emissions of carbon and other pollutions will just increase at a really high rate, causing problems in climate change, which will even affect us personally in our society. As biodiversity is an issue caused from climate change, and already we are at one of the lowest levels of biodiversity, has been reduced to a lowest level since 65 million years ago. And this becomes particularly relevant when discussing species such as bees that can become extinct if we don't change this problem with pollution that just becomes even worse with overpopulation. Already, bees have lost a large percentage of the population. Since the 1990s, 40% of bees have been lost in the United States alone. Bees help us dramatically with food in the production of crops, as they pollinate these crops. And Laura, associate professor of geography and environment at the University of Hawaii, states that the sharp contrast between the declining supply of the Earth's surfaces and the rising demand from a growing human population indicates that such services will fall short, thus exacerbating hunger and poverty. So considering that biodiversity is low and other resources are becoming low because of climate change, as I mentioned earlier, that's caused by overpopulation, we can expect this to affect us personally, as hunger and poverty will become even worse than it already is, especially since the population is growing. This just increases the amount of people affected and the amount of detriment this will cause. And at first glance, it can look like high birth rates and overpopulation may become beneficial to the economy, as if we lower these birth rates, the problem is that we have, as some state, that we have more seniors as a percentage of our population and we don't have people to replace them. But in actuality, Mora explains again that there are 560 million people currently between the ages of 55 and 64, and 1.2 billion between 5 to 14. The issue is actually the opposite. We have too many retirees, and we have too many young people and not enough jobs available, that there will be a deficit of about 640 million jobs worldwide, which is a large percentage of unemployment rates. Even if we create new jobs and new industries, that's just a ridiculous amount that we probably will not be able to completely fill, and people will live in poverty and thus will have a lower standard of living, as they won't have enough money. So how can we fix overpopulation? We can't just tell people, you know, stop having babies. We have to figure out how to solve this. And one of the ways you can do this is by establishing organizations and funding for family planning. An infographic from the UN showed that only 60% of demand for family planning in Africa is satisfied. They have some of the highest birth rates, and only 60% is a pretty low amount considering how big Africa is and how high their birth rates are. So if we can increase this family planning, then it can encourage people to start using contraceptives, and especially the married couples, it can encourage this and will lower the birth rate. But an issue with this is that some religions may not agree with the use of contraceptives, and it may prevent people from using them, but it's still vital to educate the people on this, as it can still lower some of the birth rates. Another solution is increasing women's education. It may seem like there's no correlation between the two, but trends have shown that women that are educated have children much later in life and have a tendency to have less children. And this chart shows that in places like Somalia and Niger, only 78% of the poorest females aged 7 to 16 have never been to school. Niger has the highest birth rate in the world with a rate of 7.8. So if we can increase women's education in these areas, we can actually lower the birth rate that way. But a limitation could be patriarchal societies that may not want their women to be educated, and this can create fear in women, as they may fear for their safety if they go to school. It may also be hard to fund this, but it is still important that we increase women's education and that we do this, because it will lower the birth rate, and it can help solve other issues and help increase the livelihood of those women.
Okay, a couple of questions for you, Jenna. The first one is, how valid and reliable are the sources you've used, and how do you know, and which sources didn't work?
So I examined my reliability based on, where they came from, where they were published from. A lot of my sources came from places such as National Geographic or from databases that were peer-reviewed. So I first examined that, and then I looked at the author's credentials. And a lot of my authors had experience in researching the topic, and as one of my authors, Mora, was an associate professor and had written other articles about environmental damage. And a source that didn't work, I found some biased sources from organizations that were environmentalist organizations, and some of the research didn't make sense as I was checking them and checking their facts and they cited studies that weren't reliable and had a lot of holes in the studies. So I kind of discredited those and just tried to find better sources that way.
Good. And if you had more time, what additional research would you conduct related to this issue?
I probably would have researched the scientific aspect a little bit more because climate change does affect the environment, but I think researching how maybe how that works would have helped me get a better understanding of how pollution actually really affects the environment, how it lowers the biodiversity rate and the Earth's resources and that.